I want to tell you, I am excited to be here. This, by the way, is the first time I've been to Alabama, so I was excited to be here with you tonight.
Welcome.
And also, I want to say how excited I am that you are here tonight because, not just because you've come to hear me speak, but because when you walk through that door, you joined a revolution. A revolution is taking place across the country. And the issue we're going to talk about tonight, I've been working on for almost 20 years, and we've talked to an awful lot of empty halls, but meetings like this now are taking place, hundreds of people across the country, and meeting after meeting after meeting, every single state, are meeting to talk about this issue, and that is what's getting this revolution started. So I thank you for being here for those reasons. And the official word is out about me. According to several newspapers around the country, I am here only to spread wild conspiracy rumors and scare you into fearing your own benevolent government. Guilty as charged. But you all know that something is very wrong in America. Every day, government at all levels grows more out of control, more intrusive in our personal lives, more of a threat to private property, and all in total and flagrant disregard of the expressed will of the electorate. The fact is, Americans have grown to fear our own government. Life is getting harder. There is less optimism about the future. The once prominent phrase, American dream, seems to have been dropped from our vocabulary. The reason? America is going through what Al Gore called a wrenching transformation of our society. What kind of transformation? What has changed? Where does that transformation originate? How does it directly affect you and your daily life? Well, the old structure of what was once the United States of America is being replaced with a new political and economic order that is drastically changing the very underpinnings of our nation. It is being done quietly, behind the scenes, without debate, without votes, and with no official announcement. Yet this new ruling authority has become the official policy of the federal government, every state government, and it's quickly moving into every city, town, and burg, and rural area of this country. The ruling authority is called sustainable development, and its blueprint for transforming human existence is fully outlined in a UN document called Agenda 21. Well, I've had 18 years of experience studying every aspect of sustainable development in Agenda 21, and I have learned that it is an absolute threat to everything free Americans hold dear. Here's what I know. There is a new language taking over our government. The typical city council meeting discusses comprehensive development, density, historic preservation, and partnerships between city and private business. Civic leaders organize community meetings run by facilitators as they outline a vision for the town, enforced by consensus. Free trade, social justice, consensus, carbon footprints, partnerships, preservation, stakeholders, land use, environmental protection, development, diversity, visioning, open space, heritage, comprehensive planning, critical thinking, and community service are all part of this new language. What are they really talking about? Where was such language first developed? Well, the term sustainable development was born on the pages of a United Nations document called Our Common Future. That was the official report of a 1987 UN World Commission on the Environment and Development. As a result of this report, for the first time, the use of environmental protection and human development were tied to the age-old socialist goal of international redistribution of wealth. And that is the key to understanding the true purpose of sustainable development and all of its policies: control of all facets of the economy. Here's how the United Nations described Agenda 21 in one of its own publications in 1993 in an article entitled Agenda 21, the Earth Summit Strategy to Save Our Planet. It said, quote, Agenda 21 proposes an array of actions which are intended to be implemented by every person on earth. It calls for specific changes in the activities of all people. Effective execution of Agenda 21 will require a profound reorientation of all humans, unlike anything the world has ever experienced. End quote. Have you ever heard a more powerful manifesto issued for the purpose of government? And yet, when you and I point out these things and protest against it, we are attacked as fringe radicals. Well, here is the exact course that brought Agenda 21 to America and into your local community. At the top of the infrastructure, pushing sustainable development in the United Nations is the United Nations Environmental Program, or the UNEP. But the UNEP doesn't operate on its own. It's influenced by thousands of non-governmental organizations, NGOs. These are private groups who seek to implement a special political agenda. Through the UN infrastructure, particularly through the UNEP, they have incredible power. And I should point out that a true NGO group isn't something that just pops up somewhere and somebody says, I'm an NGO. These groups are officially sanctioned and certified by the United Nations to participate in these international meetings and these efforts. They have a document that they have to fill out, an application. It's about that thick. And they pledge to implement United Nations policies. Prior to the UN Earth Summit in 1992, these sanctioned NGO groups spent considerable time writing and creating the document that would be introduced to the world as Agenda 21. At the Earth Summit, nearly every head of state signed agreement to Agenda 21, including President George H.W. Bush. Agenda 21 is not a treaty that has to be ratified by the Senate. Rather, it's what's known as a soft law policy, a guideline that the nation agrees to implement through its own legislative process. And that's the reason why it's so difficult to follow the ball from the UN down into your local community. President Bush, in signing the document, committed the U.S. to implement the policies of Agenda 21. Agenda 21 then gained huge momentum when in 1993, President Bill Clinton issued an executive order to create the President's Council on Sustainable Development and made it official U.S. policy. And take a look at who served on that council, and you will see many of the same NGOs which helped write Agenda 21 in the first place. These include Jonathan Lash of the World Resources Institute, one of the three most powerful organizations influencing the UNEP. Also on the President's Council were John Sawhill of the Nature Conservancy, and Jay Hare of the National Wildlife Federation, and Michelle Peralt, the International Vice President of the Sierra Club, all players in the creation of Agenda 21 at the UN level, now openly serving in the President's Council with a specific mission of implementing Agenda 21 into American policy. And there's an even more direct connection between Agenda 21 and our federal government. Included at the UNEP table to develop the policy, along with all these NGO groups who helped write it in the first place, are these players from our federal government. Representatives of the Department of State, the Department of Interior, the Department of Agriculture, the Environmental Protection Agency, the National Park Service, the U.S. Forest Service, and the Fish and Wildlife Service. Each of these agencies send representatives to all UNEP meetings. They sit shoulder to shoulder with the NGOs who helped write it, and they come home with policies to put in place that will affect you. Now, why do they do that if Agenda 21 is just a myth that has no effect on our government? Well, you might remember a great deal of discussion during the Clinton administration about the idea of a reinvention of government. Vice President Al Gore was put in charge of that reinvention, and that should have been our first clue. The reinvention, of course, was sustainable development. The purpose of the President's Council was to translate the guidelines of Agenda 21 into public policy to be administered by the federal government. And that step-by-step process translated into the ruling authority through which a UN plan, Agenda 21, has become unquestioned US policy throughout the nation. It was invented by NGOs through the UN. It was brought to the US through the President's Council, and through federal and state legislation is being implemented right down to the local level through the involvement of the same NGOs who helped write it. From the very top, they squeeze it out of the UN, they push it onto the federal government, they push it into the state governments, and they push it then to be implemented into the local communities. That's how it works. Sustainable development is not a local idea or a local policy. So, what is sustainable development? Well, most people think sustainable development is about conservation. It has something to do with environmentalism. That, my friends, is just the excuse. Sustainable development is about a planned central economy and redistribution of wealth on a local, state, national, and international level. The process by which it is being implemented creates a matrix of locked away land or severe land use controls, controls of energy and energy production, controls of transportation, control of industry, control of food production, control of development, control of water authority, and control of population size and growth. And most of these policies and regulations are issued under the excuse of protecting the environment. Agenda 21 is not just policy. It is a complete system to change the way you think, the way we react, the way we make decisions, and those who promote it have very specific answers as to how they want each of you to do those things. Behavior modification of every American citizen to toe the line. That's why they call it an agenda. And let me show you what I mean. The Sustainable Development logo used in most literature on the subject contains three connecting circles, each labeled one social equity, another economic prosperity, and the other ecological integrity. We know them commonly as the three E's. Let me take them one at a time. Social equity. I will tell you straight out, if you fail to grasp the social equity aspect of sustainable development, then you simply have no grasp of this issue, period. Social equity is based on a demand for social justice. Social justice is described as the right and opportunity of all people to benefit equally from the resources afforded us by society and the environment. That is a very polite way of saying redistribution of wealth. Redistribution of wealth, by the way, means everyone is equally poor, not equally rich. It means no one can move forward unless everyone else can move forward together. That's a utopian myth that cannot be achieved through government edict. And Karl Marx, by the way, was the first to coin the phrase social justice. Today, the term is used throughout sustainable literature, and it is at the root of new policy initiatives. The sustainable system is based on the principle that individuals must give up selfish wants for the needs of the community or the common good. This is the same policy behind the push to eliminate our nation's borders, to allow the migration of those from other nations into the United States to share our individually created wealth and our taxpayer-paid government social programs. Borders, they say, stop the natural migration of the human race. National sovereignty, they say, is a social injustice. According to the sustainablists, it is a social injustice for some to have prosperity if others do not. Profits are made at the expense of the people. In short, social equity through sustainable development is a means to a forced utopia with promises of health care for all, jobs for all, housing for all, and equality for all. So, the reason the government refuses to secure our borders is because it is committed to imposing sustainable development. The reason Congress refused to listen to your pleas against socialized health care is because it is committed to sustainable development. Simply do a Google search of sustainable medicine, and you will find over 5,850,000 references to sustainable medicine containing most of the provisions of Obamacare. And incredibly, a new social justice policy making its way through state governments is called, are you ready? Gross National Happiness. The GNH. Under the health plank of the Agenda 21, it is an attempt to qualify in psychological terms general well-being. If allowed to move forward, gross national happiness will slowly replace gross national product as the standard to measure the health of our nation. Rather than using economics, which confuses everyone, it will measure social trends that affect quality of life. Gross national happiness preaches that the pursuit of money and things causes stress and degrades the environment. Again, it laments that only some achieve rich, comfortable lives, so the only answer is to equally spread the wealth. Redistribution, confiscation, rules and regulations. I don't know about you, but all that government causes me a lot of stress. And it makes me very unhappy. Gross national happiness is then combined with, are you ready? The Happy Planet Index. This was developed by an NGO group, and I'm sure with a bunch of your money, an NGO group called the New Economy Foundation. Get that, the New Economy. At its core, the Happy Planet Index argues that long and happy lives must be the nation's ultimate goal and not merely insatiable economic goals. This is, of course, based on the idea that some planners in a government office taking a survey of what makes us happy and then applies some psychological mumbo-jumbo to the results is the proper role of government. And you wonder why the economy is collapsing as the rantings from a bad LSD trip become serious policy actually considered by real government agencies? What I've just revealed to you comes from official documents from the state of Maryland. And I also looked this up. There are 381,000 references to gross national happiness on the internet. A few weeks ago, In Tennessee, there was a major sustainabilist rally demanding gross national happiness. Gross national happiness is the same as social justice, and it is key to understanding the many policies of Agenda 21. The second E, economic prosperity. At the root of Agenda 21 economics are public-private partnerships, pulled together into a government-driven economy called corporatism. It is not capitalism or free markets, though it may have many of the same trappings. The marketplace is still there, but ultimately corporatism does not trust the marketplace to do what the elites want done. The partnerships allow for special tax breaks, access to land for some developers but not for others, non-compete clauses in government projects that guarantee profits, access to grants and lucrative special government projects, and much more. Under public-private partnerships, there is a guarantee of protection and profits, or what they call profits. Corporations that play ball get the power of government, and government gets to hide behind the independence of business. Thus, the partnership between government and corporations is done at the expense of ordinary people, the exact opposite effect of free markets controlled by consumers. This is the new way business is being run in America under sustainable development. The business plan of the day, lobby for regulations. They argue that it's good for the economy, creating jobs by destroying things from the past. They say it's good for the economy to enforce regulations to make people buy things they didn't need before. It is certainly not free enterprise or open markets. The true description is government-sanctioned monopolies, right out of the Mussolini fascist playbook. The 30, ecological integrity. Well, as I said, that's just the excuse. To understand the power of the transformation of society under sustainable development, consider this quote from the UN's Biodiversity Treaty, which was also introduced at the 1992 Earth Summit. It says, quote, "Nature has an integral set of different values, cultural, spiritual, and material, where humans are one strand in nature's web, and all living creatures are considered equal. Therefore, the natural way is the right way, and human activity should be molded along nature's rhythms," end quote. This quote lays down the ground rules for the entire sustainable development agenda. It says, humans are nothing special. Just one strand in the nature of things, or put another way, humans are simply biological resources. Sustainable policy interprets any action that man takes as a direct threat to the environment. That is necessary, sustainable say, because humans only defile nature. In other words, sustainableists view man as nothing more than a swarm of locusts which sweeps down on nature and sucks it clean until there's nothing left. Nothing good comes from man, according to the sustainableist doctrine. And private property ownership and control is a main target of sustainable development. Consider this quote from the report of the 1976 UN's Habitat One conference, which said, quote, "Land cannot be treated as an ordinary asset controlled by individuals and subject to the pressures of and inefficiencies of the market. Private land ownership is also a principal instrument of accumulation and concentration of wealth, and therefore contributes to social injustice. Property ownership is a social injustice." The fact is, Agenda 21 is a blueprint to completely change our society to a top-down, planned central economy in a strange mixture of socialism, fascism, and corporatism. But to convince Americans to accept it required something that would get us to sacrifice our natural rights voluntarily. The answer? Environmental Armageddon. You must sacrifice freedom to protect the planet. It's urgent, we're told. Do you doubt that? Then consider this quote by Alexander King, the co-founder of the Club of Rome. He said, quote, "In searching for a new enemy to unite us, we came up with the idea that pollution, the threat of global warming, water shortages, famine and the like would fit the bill. All of these dangers are caused by human intervention. The real enemy then is humanity," end quote. So the urgency is on. Global warming is feeding the hysteria. There's no time to consider things like individual concerns and wants and needs. Selfish, cries the sustainableist. We must save the environment. Go green. Get out of your car. Stop using energy. Sacrifice. Cut your carbon footprint or perish. And so, federal and state governments, working hand in hand with a horde of non-governmental organizations, private groups with personal political agendas, force passage of rules and regulations passed down to local communities. But, say your local officials, none of that UN socialist stuff is going on here, just conspiracy theories by right-wing radicals. We're just creating the tools necessary in a local effort to manage growth and development for our community, they say. Have you heard these denials?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Then consider this quote by J. Gary Lawrence, a planner for the city of Seattle and an advisor to the President's Council on Sustainable Development. He said, quote, "Participating in a UN-advocated planning process would very likely bring out many who would actively work to defeat any elected official undertaking Local Agenda 21. So, we will call our process something else, such as comprehensive planning, growth management, or smart growth." Local indeed. Sustainable development is the process by which America is being reorganized around the central principle of state collectivism using the environment as bait. This is a political movement led by those who seek to control the world economy, dictate development, and redistribute the world's wealth. They use the philosophical base of Karl Marx, the tactics of Adolf Hitler, and the rhetoric of the Sierra Club. everything connected with sustainable development translates to higher costs, shortages, and sacrifice. The best way to understand what sustainable development actually is by discovering what they say is not sustainable. Maurice Strong, the Secretary General of the Earth Summit, said, quote, "Current lifestyles and consumption patterns of the affluent middle class involving high meat intake, use of fossil fuels, appliances, home and work air conditioning, and suburban housing are not sustainable." And keep in mind, if they say it's not sustainable, they really mean we gotta ban it. Suburban housing? Air conditioning? You are. So, how is this wrenching transformation being put into place? Well, there are four very specific routes being used. In the rural areas, it's called the Wildlands Project. In the cities, it's called Smart Growth. In business, it's called Public-Private Partnerships. And in government, it's called Stakeholder Councils and Non-Elected Boards and Regional Government, or Reinvented Government. Let me take them one at a time. First, the Wildlands Project. It was the brainchild of Earth First's Dave Foreman. And it literally calls for the rewilding of 50% of all the land in every state back to the way it was before Christopher Columbus set foot here. In 1983, when Foreman first dreamed up the scheme for the Wildlands Project, he said, quote, "It is not enough to preserve the roadless, undeveloped country remaining. We must recreate wilderness in large regions, move out the cars and civilized people, dismantle the roads and dams, reclaim the plowed lands and clear cuts, and reintroduce extirpated species." Sounds like reading the front page of the newspaper, doesn't it?
Yes.
Destruction of human civilization was his goal. In reality, the Wildlands Project is a diabolical plan to herd people off the rural lands and into human settlements. Crazy, you say? Yes. Impossible? Not so fast. From the demented mind of Dave Foreman, the plan became the blueprint for the UN's biodiversity treaty. So now the scheme is international in scope with the power of law. Thomas Lovejoy, a science advisor to the Federal Department of Interior, said, quote, "We will map the whole nation, determine development for the whole country, and regulate it." And your local elected officials are helping to implement this insanity. Yet they are quick to deny that any such ideas have their origins at the international level. They accuse me of wearing a tinfoil hat and hearing voices. Well, here's a voice I hear. Again, Maurice Strong said at the Earth Summit, quote, "Isn't the only hope for the planet that the industrialized nations collapse? Isn't it our responsibility to bring that about?" And that is the true agenda we face. But how do you remove people from the land? Well, one step at a time. There are many tools in place to stop human activity and grow the wilderness. Deny grazing and water rights on public lands. It becomes impossible for the rancher to run the ranch, and eventually he goes out of business. Lock away natural resources by creating more national parks. It shuts down the mines, and they go out of business. Call every mosquito-infested swamp and occasional mud puddle a wetlands, and ban any development around it. Invent a spotted owl shortage and pretend it can't live in a forest where timber is cut. Shut off the forest. Then when no trees are cut, there's nothing to feed the mills, and there are no jobs, and they go out of business, and in many cases, whole towns die. The governor of Maryland is enforcing an agenda without a vote by the legislature, he's doing it through executive order, called Plan Maryland, that will lock away over 400,000 acres of land banned from any development for at least 20 years. One of the key provisions is a policy to ban septic tanks as a means to protect the Chesapeake Bay, even though there is no evidence anywhere that says septic tanks do any damage whatsoever. The only result of that ban will be to make it impossible to live in a rural area, unless you want to spend several million dollars on a private water treatment plant. Getting people off the rural lands and into the cities is the real purpose, not environmental protection. Well, the Wildlands Project comes in many names and many programs. Wilderness areas, comprehensive land use plans, bikeways, greenways, heritage areas, land management, rails to trails, open space, wolf and bear reintroduction, conservation easements, and many, many more. Each of these programs is designed to make it just a little harder to live on the land, a little more expensive, a little more hopeless. In reality, the process is simply herding people off of rural land and into human habitat areas, the cities. And that brings us to the second path to sustainable development. It's called smart growth. They put a line around the city and they tell you no growth can take place outside of that line. Urban sprawl, they say disdainfully. They refuse to build more roads as a ploy to get you out of your car and into public transportation, restricting mobility. New highways, they say, are feeders to more development. They stop widening existing roads for the same reasons. So roads become overcrowded and gridlock, and they blame development. Their new ploy is to force cars to share the road with bicycles, the complete street, they call it. In many smart growth cities, new apartment buildings now have no garages or parking lots. We don't want any stinking cars here. Smart growth creates an unnatural restriction on space inside the controlled area, so now there's a shortage of houses and prices go up. That means populations will have to be controlled because now there's a shortage of land. And that's why kindly, compassionate environmentalist Dr. Jacques Cousteau declared, quote, "In order to stabilize world populations, we must eliminate 350,000 people per day," end quote. Sustainabilists call for an 85% reduction in human populations. Now, I've made arrangements here with Woody to set up outside when you leave. There are containers of Kool-Aid out there. I expect all of you to do your patriotic duty and take a drink, and I guarantee you there will be no environmentalists standing in your way to join me. 85% reduction in populations. How's that to be done? Do we use the proven success of China's population control methods of forced abortions and sterilization? The Chinese, I can tell you, are huge supporters of sustainable development, and I'm sure they are anxious to share some ideas with us. Of course, comprehensive development plans are the tool of choice in nearly every city in the nation to produce the proper smart growth community. Through these plans, energy and water is tightly controlled. Smart growth advocates force individuals to live in denser communities that take up smaller tracts of land per housing unit if you're allowed to have a suburban house. What they prefer is a high-rise building that you live on the top of. There are offices for business on the middle, and there are stores on the bottom. You never get to touch the ground. That's a sustainable community. Planning advocates and government bureaucrats are forcing such planned communities across the state and the nation. And those plans put severe controls on private property. The truth is, there can be no private property in a sustainable smart growth community. It's community property. And the third way to sustainable development, inside the human habitat areas, our cities and our towns, government is steadily being controlled by an elite ruling class called stakeholder councils. These are mostly NGOs who, like thieves in the night, just show up to stake their claim to enforce their own private political agendas. The function of legitimate government, elected government, is within the sustainable system is fast becoming little more than the rubber stamp to create and enforce the dictates of the councils. It's the demise of representative government. And the councils appear and grow almost overnight. You'll find watershed councils that regulate human action near every trickling stream, river, or lake. Meters are put on wells. Special action councils control home size, tree pruning, or removal, even the color you can paint your home or the height of your grass. Historic preservation councils control development in downtown areas, disallowing expansion and new building. Sometimes they even disallow repairs on existing buildings unless specific Perhaps expensive, perhaps even non-existent materials are used. And let me tell you this about historic preservation. You are conservative people. You love our history. You love our culture. You love our United States of America, our founding documents. History is important to you. How many have history books at home? How many study history?
Amen.
You love history. Mm-hmm. They are using historic preservation as the way to sucker you into accepting these policies. In the rural lands, we find the establishment of fire safety councils that prevent those living in rural areas from removing vegetation and dead trees from wooded areas on their own land, because to do so wouldn't be natural and damages the ecology. So as a result of all of these councils, forests can't be cut, farmers have to pay taxes to draw from their own wells, commercial fishermen can't fish, and regulations cover all possible human activity. Once the councils are established, it becomes nearly impossible to discuss issues with your elected officials. Instead, they will automatically refer you to the proper council or administration or department run by unresponsive appointed hacks who have their own political agendas, and they don't care what your problem is. These same non-elected councils fit almost perfectly the definition of a state Soviet, a system of councils that report to an apex council and then implement a predetermined outcome. Soviets are the operating mechanism of a government-controlled economy, the exact opposite of a constitutional republic. And the fourth path to sustainable development, as I mentioned, public-private partnerships. You hear the propaganda of the public-private partnerships nightly on your television as their commercials tell you to go green. And they use Congress to build more wealth and power. General Electric in Sylvania used its partnership with government to ban its own product, the incandescent light bulb, and replace it with the new green bulbs. By next year, you won't be allowed to buy 100-watt incandescent bulbs. Why? Because GE in Sylvania can make three times as much from the new ones because they're more expensive. Such is the reality of green industry. Mm-hmm. The truth is, there would be very little legitimate green industry if not for the billions of dollars in grant money shelled out to the partnerships to develop alternative energy schemes. In fact, wind energy may well be the least sustainable and least eco-friendly of all electricity options. It probably requires more energy to manufacture, haul, and install these monstrous windmills in your transmission systems than that windmill will generate in its lifetime. Yet, the nation, in the name of sustainable development, is investing everything in our future to enforce windmills and alternative energy over real energy providers. Alternative energy amounts to less than 1% of our nation's energy needs. And for every green job created, two in legitimate industry are lost because of green rules and regulations. America has now discovered that it has a near infinite amount of shale oil in literally every state. Rather than celebrate our good fortune to reduce gas prices and eliminate our dependency on foreign oil cartels, the sustainabilists are rushing in a near panic to block the drilling of shale oil. And moreover, recent government reports show we have more than 2 trillion barrels of untapped oil under American soil, more than anywhere else in the world, more than enough to take us into the next 500 years. It's untapped and banned because of sustainable policy. To the sustainabilist elite, who loathe competition and free markets, such a change in the status quo is terrifying because their control is highly profitable for those industries that take the tax money through the public-private partnerships. And now, there is a new kind of corporation being developed through public-private partnerships. It's called benefit corporations. Imagine a legislative brotherhood of business where favored businesses get to go to the front of the line for permits, licenses, and opportunities merely because they agree to advance the principles of sustainable development and Agenda 21. Benefit corporations. Six states already have benefit corporation legislation: Hawaii, Virginia, Maryland, Vermont, New Jersey, and New York. And five more are in the process of making it part of their state corporate legal system, including California, Colorado, Michigan, Pennsylvania, and North Carolina. This policy will destroy free enterprise and guarantee that we cannot stop Agenda 21. Now, many Americans ask how dangerous international policies can suddenly turn up in local government, all seemingly uniform to those in communities around the nation and around the globe. The answer? Meet ICLEI, a nonprofit private foundation dedicated to helping your mayor implement all of these policies. Originally known as the International Council for Local Environmental Initiatives, today the group simply calls itself ICLEI Local Governments for Sustainability. They had to get that word international out of there. In 1992, ICLEI was one of the groups instrumental in creating Agenda 21. It then made it its mission to go to communities around the world and implement it, and it's having incredible success. ICLEI is now operating in more than 600 cities in all 50 states. The group is shooting for 1,000 members over the next 3 years. Each of these cities pay dues to ICLEI to receive its programs. When local governments contract with ICLEI, they agree to implement the Agenda 21 policy of sustainable development. And here's just some of the programs ICLEI provides cities and towns in order to spread their own particular political agenda in the name of community service and environmental protection. They bring in software products and associated training, access to networks of experts and newsletters and conferences and training workshops, toolkits, online resources, case studies, fact sheets, policy and practice manuals. These tools are used to fully indoctrinate employees at City Hall to assure only sustainable policies are considered. And then there's notification of relevant grant opportunities. That's the important one. Money with severe strings attached. For example, here's a direct quote from the EPA's website concerning one of its grant programs. It says, quote, "The Sustainable Development Challenge Grant Program is also a step in implementing Agenda 21, the global plan of action on sustainable development signed by the United States at the Earth Summit in 1992. All of these programs require broad community participation to identify and address environmental issues," end quote. So, to local officials who continue to deny any connection to Agenda 21 in their community, please take note. It is the EPA which said these grants were designed to implement Agenda 21, not me. But keep in mind, your community does not have to be an ICLEI member to be affected by Agenda 21. And ICLEI policies around the nation. ICLEI partners with other established organizations like the American Planning Association and the International City County Management Association, or the ICMA, and then there's the Renaissance Planning Group. These groups and hundreds more like them work hand in hand with groups like the U.S. Conference of Mayors, the National Governors Association, the National League of Cities, the National Association of County Administrators, and many more that your elected officials probably belong to. These are the people making policy. These are the people your local officials trust to be mainstream. These are the true enemies of freedom in America. And that's how these policies quickly spread across the nation as enforced regulations. And here's some of the results of those efforts. Across the nation, state legislatures are passing laws requiring cities and towns to establish comprehensive development plans that include high-density urban development areas, controls on energy and water use, controls on transportation, making it more difficult to drive cars, perhaps even forcing acceptance of light rail and high-speed trains. These laws are now being used as a weapon to force sustainable development at a rapid pace around the nation. And here is some of what each of you can now expect from these plans that your city fathers say will make things better. One of the most popular tools now to control energy use is the energy audit in the building review. They establish quotas for electrical use and for heating and cooling pumps and water use. That means that government bureaucrats will likely come into your home or your office building and determine the amount of potential energy you should have. You will be given a list of recommendations necessary to bring your home into compliance. These may include the need for a new roof, or new energy-efficient appliances, or new windows, things that you really probably weren't planning to buy. In Oakland, California, the City Council did just these things, and the result was an average cost for every single homeowner of $35,000.
Oh.
And if you don't comply, you will be fined and possibly unable to sell your home until you do. Across the nation, power companies, in partnership with their government planners, are forcing the use of smart meters. These meters contain RFID chips. The technology enables the power company to keep track of how much power you are using and controlling, and regulate and ration your use of that electricity. They will set the temperature in your home. If they decide that you're using too much hot water for your showers or your washing machines, or too much air conditioning, your electricity will automatically be turned down or even off. Moreover, a future goal is to have all appliances replaced with those containing those same RFID chips, which the smart meter will speak to for more regulations and controls. There is now growing evidence that the smart meters are causing medical problems for some that are affected by the radiation that comes from them. Others are experiencing lack of power during the high peak usage. And of course, as with all things sustainable, energy costs are soaring. Those who protest that such meters are a violation of their private property rights and their freedom of choice are told that their only choice is to either accept the meters or there'll be no power brought to their homes. And it just keeps getting wilder. Under the title of sustainable farming, the planners are excited about a new sustainable style of tractor to pull the plow. It's called a team of oxen. They're serious. There is a college in Vermont, Green Mountain College. Look it up on the internet. It teaches sustainable farming, and they are so proud of their herd of oxen. Students are paying for an education, a college education, to learn Davy Crockett's farming techniques.
Yeah.
There are now policies being advocated to place taxes on the use of toilet paper, on the number of miles you drive in your car, and on the use of plastic bags. In many places, they're just outright banning them. Next on the agenda is to, quote, radically abandon the flush toilet. They call it, quote, one of the world's most destructive habits. Shame on you. The Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation has made a donation of $3 million to 8 universities to reinvent the flush toilet. I believe that we should take up a collection to reinvent the computer so that it does not accept Microsoft software. I kid you not, the title of the headline of my next newsletter will be Bill Gates, the World's Richest Useful Idiot. The EPA is now providing funding to NGO groups to run training programs for people to photograph and report neighbors who may be committing crimes against the environment. This summer, the Obama signed Executive Order 13575 to create the White House Rural Council. The council is a list of the most aggressive agencies and departments of the U.S. government. It will bring an army of regulators into rural areas to completely control every decision of land use, farming, and development. Farmers who have been feeding America for over 200 years will not be able to make a single decision without permission and massive paperwork from bureaucrats from over 25 agencies. Overlapped again. Not to satisfy one agency, it could be all 25. The result can only be food shortages and higher prices. And several cities are now taking grant money to create a plug-in deployment program using your tax dollars to assure the city is ready for electric cars. Last Saturday, I spoke in Raleigh, North Carolina. Raleigh's plug-in program is called Project Get Ready. They're so excited. This is the stated purpose of Project Get Ready. Follow the bouncing ball. Facilitate stakeholder working groups in resolving issues related to plug-in vehicles. Educate consumers about plug-in vehicles. Establish convenient and grid-compatible plug-in vehicle charging infrastructure. Develop relationships with plug-in vehicle and component manufacturers, and this is my favorite part, with the manufacturers, ensure vehicle availability in the North Carolina market. Make sure that we have some of those electric cars. What are there, 10 of them in the country? Explore opportunities for economic development related to plug-in vehicles. Just think about it. What? What you have here in five parts is the entire sustainabilist agenda. You've got facilitators and stakeholders. When it says educate consumers about plug-in vehicles, you've got social equity. When it talks about developing relationships with the manufacturers, you've got public-private partnerships. It's all here. All the three E's are working. All the components are there in that one program, and that's how it works. The program openly admits, this is my favorite part, it openly admits that all of this is necessary because otherwise people won't buy plug-in vehicles. You know, at least under the free enterprise system, the oil companies paid for their own filling stations. And free Americans chose what kind of car they wanted to buy. And Al Gore calls this the horrors of the 20th century industrial revolution. Welcome to the utopia of sustainable development. This, my friends, is Big Brother at its worst. It's a planned control enforced by your local leaders and representatives in partnership with groups like ICLEI, an organization whose vice chairman, Harvey Revens, said, quote, individual rights will have to take a back seat to the collective. Let me ask you this. Would any of your elected representatives openly admit to enforcing communism in your community? No. Then why are they so eager to be in partnership with an organization which does? The United States is not a global village run by elders who hand down the rules from on high. We are a nation of individuals whose rights are supposed to be protected and guaranteed by the representatives that we elect. We demand accountability from them. However, global forces which do not accept the unique American form of government sneak behind the curtain, avoiding controversy and honest debate. The only possible result can be a tyranny over a powerless electorate stripped of their rights, their property, and their self-determination. Global warming has been the excuse for the hysteria, but true science now shows that to be the greatest hoax ever perpetrated on humankind. So there's no need for these dire policies to cut back our carbon footprint by forcing us to lock away land and resources and live in high-density cracker boxes. We all want a clean environment. However, what we're objecting to here is not environmental protection, but the process that's being used in its name. There is nothing local or innocent or normal about it. Again, it starts as an international agenda created by ideological zealots working hand in hand through massive international gatherings sponsored through the United Nations. At those massive meetings, documents are carefully prepared for the signatures of leaders of every nation, including the United States. Once signed, The bureaucracies of our federal government use documents like Agenda 21 as a blueprint for legislation and regulations. To write that legislation, the bureaucrats work hand in hand with the same NGOs who wrote the UN documents. And then, these UN-sanctioned NGOs like the Sierra Club and the Nature Conservancy team up with groups like ICLEI and the American Planning Association to apply pressure and make sure your city, local city councils and county supervisors toe the line. The resulting non-elected boards, councils, and regional governments appointed by an oligarchy answerable to no one is the perfect definition of a Soviet, a centrally controlled economy. And I assure you, we cannot restore our unique American Republic if our communities are little Soviets. Nor can we protect the environment if our economy is destroyed and free men and women are unable to make choices other than survival in a sustainabilist tyranny. The sustainabilists are using our carbon footprint as a measure of our guilt. One fact is sure. If you have no carbon footprint, you are dead. Elected officials can no longer play ignorant about the origins of their policies. America is dying while they're denying. It is their elected duty to represent the people and protect them from these piranhas that are devouring our way of life. To save it, you must take action now. And understand that the main battle to stop Agenda 21 and sustainable development is being fought not in Congress, right here on the local level. We must stand up and protest at every city council and county commissioner meeting, at every planning board, and every consensus meeting. Fight the creation of non-elected councils, commissions, or boards because they can and they will be used as a weapon against your ability to deal in reason with your local government. Above all, refuse federal or state money or new sustainable programs and get rid of the old ones. And if ICLEI and the American Planning Association are running things in your town, and I'm sure they are, throw them out. Yeah. Stop payment of dues, disband anything that they have built, and start looking for some high-grade tar and feathers. Yeah. And if you're a local elected officials, continue to ignore you while playing footsie with those leading this tyranny, then you must force them out of office. Your survival depends on it. Right. Exactly. Nameless, faceless bureaucrats wielding power in the back rooms, untouchable and unseen, is not freedom. The sustainabilists now haunt the upper levels of every chamber of the federal government, our state houses, and our city council chambers. In these very dangerous times, it is easy to despair over the nation's future. They have achieved many of their goals, but they have not yet won. Their whole agenda is built on a house of cards that stands only when you are ignorant and compliant. And their arrogance and their impatience to force the policy into place is resulting in a stir of the American people. We are beginning to move the rock of freedom uphill. We are on the threshold of great change because the word is quickly spreading about Agenda 21. After 18 years of issuing warnings about Agenda 21, finally, opposition is being heard. In the past 10 months, the following communities have taken action, official action, to revoke their contracts with ICLEI, starting in January with Carroll County, Maryland, then Amador County, California, then Montgomery County, Pennsylvania, then Edmond, Oklahoma, then Las Cruces, New Mexico, then Spartanburg, South Carolina, then James City County, Virginia, then Albemarle County, Virginia, the home of Thomas Jefferson, then Plantation, Florida, then Lexington, Virginia. Now we can add to this Carver, Massachusetts, Pinellas County, Florida, Garland, Texas, Sarasota County, Florida, Abington, Virginia, and most recently, Clallam County, Washington. Yay. Each of these communities have taken the first step toward ending Agenda 21 in their community, but it is only the first step. They must continue. And there's more. In the Washington State Legislature, Representative Matt Shea is taking steps to establish an anti-Agenda 21 caucus. In Bonner County, Idaho, Commissioner Cornell Razor is succeeding in establishing a property rights council as an official arm of the county government. It will oversee all legislation coming before the county commission and will determine if it violates property rights. And this idea is quickly spreading across the nation. Activists in Tennessee are already moving to implement property rights councils in their communities. The state of Wisconsin, the state legislature, now has a bill that will allow local community governments to repeal comprehensive development plans that were forced under smart growth legislation. It also eliminates the grant program that was set up to finance the smart growth schemes. And finally, in Florida, the state legislature has passed and the governor has signed legislation to repeal smart growth legislation. That means that now the counties are free from state mandates. This is landmark legislation. I was privileged the other night to meet one of the legislators who did this. But the joy of victory comes with a very serious warning in Florida. It's not over. It's just begun. There will now be even more severe efforts in local communities by the sustainabilists. And they will increase efforts in the state legislature to reinstate the policies and target any legislator who supported it. We've got to stand with these legislators more than we've ever done before. But revolution against sustainable development is taking place in every corner of this nation. And a panic, ICLEI, is now rushing to cleanse its website of any mention of the United Nations. Our opponents are trying their best to ridicule us and paint our movement as extremists. It's not working. We are getting stronger every day. For the first time since I started down the road to expose Agenda 21, I believe we will succeed in crushing it. Just finish with this. You know, recently I watched the film Robin Hood starring Russell Crowe, and I was struck by the similarities between England of the 13th century and today's America. It was a time of serfs who had no rights, no property, and only poverty in their future. It was a time when the king owned everything from land to livestock, and it was a time when tax collectors could literally confiscate everything you had in the name of the king, leaving you with virtually nothing. The people attempted to rise up, demanding that the king give them legal rights from which they could be guaranteed the ability to benefit from the fruits of their own labor. The people of the 13th century England knew what they had to do if ever they were going to be free. The slogan under which they organized was, "Rise and rise again until lambs become lions." Today, as we face an ever-growing tyranny by a Congress and a president, as well as elected officials at every level who ignore you, lie to you, and deny their actions that you can plainly see, Americans, for the first time in our history, face the same evil those Englishmen faced so long ago. And so today, I appeal to you to take the same resolve today. Begin that effort to rise up and continue to fight again and again at city council and county commissioner meetings. Take their ridicule and return the fight again. Stand up to these self-proclaimed stakeholders and outsider NGOs, the carpetbaggers of our day. Reach out to your neighbors and help them see what a threat Agenda 21 is to their freedom. Never give in. Rise and rise again until lambs become lions. Yeah.